Telling the story tonight, today, the best woman in the world. Please welcome back to the masked stage, Megan Pratt.
Hi. This is so fun. I'm going to tell a story today. It's called The Best Woman in the World. But first, I have to talk directly to Julie's camera and say, Mom, I'm sorry, it's not about you. It's a quote. I wish every one of you could have met my Aunt Wilma. There aren't any more Wilmas, if you notice. Not too many out there. No little Wilmas crawling around. We do have an Elsie. Mm-hmm. But my Auntie Wilma was my grandma, her sister, her younger sister. And so my Aunt Wilma was sturdy, solid, dependable, reliable, patient, and she thought I was amazing. Mm-hmm. And when I was a little kid, I was the weird kid. You know, you maybe think you had that wrapped up. I had that wrapped up. Because I was a little kid with ADHD and something called dyspraxia, which means I'm klutz, watch your stuff, watch your food. Okay. And that made the world not safe for me. I don't have the ADHD where you go climb and jump off the garage roof. That was my brother. Mm-hmm. I have the kind of ADHD where I focus. I can do the same thing for 8 hours. While I'm doing it, I will forget to eat. I will forget that I have children. I will forget that I have to get up and go to work tomorrow. Mm-hmm. That's how the hyperfocus works. And with the dyspraxia, there's a gap. I don't even know how to explain it. It's like there's a gap between what my brain wants my mouth to say or what my brain wants my hands to do. And there's a disconnect. Mm-hmm. And so I'll be painting and all of a sudden I don't have this spasm and all of a sudden I've ruined what I've just spent 8 hours on. Mm-hmm. This is my life. Mm-hmm. And so I don't necessarily understand how the world works. I might be on a dance floor having a great time at 8 years old dancing. I don't care that there's nobody else out there with me because my world is this big. Mm-hmm. I don't understand how my behavior impacts other people. It never occurred to me that somebody watched me do that. Okay. So when you're a little kid and you're growing up in an alcoholic family, my dad was pretty drunk. We're just going to go ahead and say that. Dad was a drunk. And mom worked, and there were three of us. And my brother and I were only 14 months apart. And so what he didn't think of, I did. Mm-hmm. And in my baby book, it says, man, just fix it, Sean. Yeah, I had ADHD. It was funny three times. Clearly, it's funny the sixth again, right? Mm-hmm. No. That is not the feedback that you get from the world. So I had this Auntie Wilma. And did any of y'all have an extra grandma? Mm-hmm. I had a full complement of grandmas. I had two great grandmas. I had great grandpas. And then I had this Auntie Wilma. And she didn't have any kids. And some people would say, oh, there goes Wilma with her pet again. When you're a little kid and you screw everything up, there's got to be a place where you can go where you're amazing. Mm-hmm. Where you don't screw up and you don't get yelled at and you don't break things. And if you do, it's no big deal because she got it at Tursties. You know? Mm-hmm. Oh, this is nice, nice china. Yeah, I bought it with the groceries. You bought a piece a week. Remember that? Mm-hmm. Well, that woman and I spent so much time together out at her farm. She would just come into town and she would pick me up, or she'd pick up me and Sean, and we would go up to the farm. My older sister hardly ever came because she was busy with one of my other two grandmothers who thought she was amazing. Now, as a middle child in an alcoholic family, you get zero attention. Zero. And it goes outside of your house, too. I had a home ec teacher mark me absent for an entire year. There. Did you see my sewing project? I can't sew. My Auntie Wilma tried to teach me to sew. And so I would sit next to her on the couch, you know, the brown one with kind of the nylon, scratch the back of your legs. Mm-hmm. And we would sew. She made dish towels. She embroidered. And she would take the things to the fair. And I'm like, oh, I want a purple ribbon. Because mm-hmm. she didn't get blue ribbons. She got purple ribbons. Grand mm-hmm. champion. And stunning things. And sometimes she'd make an apron, but mostly dish towels, because that was her thing. When you got married, you got your set of dish towels from Aunt Wilma. Mm-hmm. What did the dish towel say? Monday. Wash. Thursday shop, Friday clean, Saturday cook, Sunday rest. But she also did a lot of resting because honestly, it was just she and her husband Ronnie. They didn't have any kids. House was pretty clean. She had plenty of time to do other things. Part of the reason that we got along so well because we had this uncanny ability to stay out of each other's business. Okay? Mm-hmm. We could live together for a week. And as long as she watched The Price is Right and her stories, mm-hmm. you didn't bother her during her stories. That was a given. and then the afternoons were just like mine. And all the catalogs, remember the catalogs? Mm-hmm. Sears and JCPenney and the Wish Book and Montgomery Ward's. Remember Montgomery Ward's?
Mm-hmm.
I would sit with those catalogs and a scissor and envelopes, and I would just build myself families and families and families. And you get this whole family, and all their names start with G, and then you can't find a baby. So mm-hmm. you have a baby, and then family. Anyway, catalogs were kind of hard for paper dolls. But anyway, we had this great, just sort of mutual admiration society going on. And it was awesome for me. Because we would go to town. I was on a first-name basis with Wally the Eggman, Jan at the Jelly Mill, and what was his name? He did her hair. Anyway, Mr. Johnson. I don't know his last name is Johnson. He did her hair. Friday mornings, you could find me anywhere in Redwood Falls wandering the streets because she was getting her hair done from 8 to 10.
Mm-hmm.
We had $5. Mm-hmm. I had my $5, Sean had his $5. It's all okay. But there was this safety with her, and there was this understanding that everything was going to be okay. And so she tried to teach me to sew. She did crossword puzzles. That was her other hobby. And I'm like, why? I know so many words. So I'd be like, how do you spell this? And I'd be like, blah, blah, blah. Well, what's another word for blah, 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 blah? What does the word a C mean? You're lost. You're confused. I read her on the dictionary. She would read the clue, and I would look it up in the dictionary. So from the time I was 7, I could get that big crossword puzzle dictionary on my lap. I was looking up words. Of course I'm smart. I don't love the words. I just don't know how to say them. Because I read them. Mm-hmm. Auntie Wilma came with this. One more thing. This is important to the story. She kept a diary. We had this routine, you know. We'd have supper, Hogan's Heroes, and then about 8 o'clock we would have dessert. Because you always woke up in the morning to some amazing thing baking. You know, we'd have the apple pie, but you don't get it until 8 o'clock at night. Mm-hmm. Anyway, after we'd had dessert and she'd washed up the dishes and I'd helped because I was required to help out, mind my manners, and be kind, you know, every day out the door. And then she would sit down and she would open the drawer in her empty, that's the word, pull out her little diary for the year. They were all stamped with the year and her name. And she would just jot down a couple of notes. And I'd say, what you writing? Well, that's none of your business. These are my thoughts. These are just for me. And she would close it up with her pen and stick it back in the drawer and shut it. I never once broke her trust. She would go out and mow for hours. That drawer's right there. I never once opened it. So we just sort of trotted along and there's just this wonderful safety, if that makes sense to you. Mm-hmm. And then when I was 15, they said she had cancer. I'm like, what do you mean she has cancer? She has liver cancer. And I watched my strong, sturdy aunt just fade right in front of my eyes. Now, I do not do well with dying. Anyone is at a very young age. And she was my first close to me person who had died. And I didn't know what to do. And then there's this Uncle Ronnie who I just adored, and he adored us. Because with the extra grandma, you get an extra grandpa, right?
Mm-hmm.
And Ronnie was a truck driver, and he got up every morning at 4 o'clock, and she got up with him, and she made his lunch, and he would go. And he struggled. He struggled while she was sick. And it was the first time I ever saw him be kind of angry. And he wasn't angry at her, he was angry because he couldn't do anything. But honestly, I'd never, ever seen anger or disappointment or dislike on either of their faces towards each other. It was amazing just to be in that kind of, I mean, my mom and dad, granny, throw some alcohol in any relationship and it can do some damage.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't have that out at their house. They didn't have that. And so And so Aunt Lola died, and we're at the funeral, and they didn't have any children of their own. You know, just Wilma's pets, Wilma Nan before me, Gigi was coming up after me when Aunt Lola died, and the gentleman at the funeral, he says, "Brownie, who do you want to sit with you?" And he pointed at me. Mm. And I was 15, and I was like, "What does that even mean? What am I supposed to do? What? All I had to do was hold his hand. Mm. All I had to do was hold his hand and be strong, sturdy, and safe while I sat next to him, and so that we could get this stuff together. I stuck to him like glue until he said, "Shoot." Because, you know, 2 hours of Megan is a lot. And so we had Ronnie. We said goodbye to Wilma, and we had Ronnie. And 7 years maybe, he had 2 strong attacks, and then his heart just busted for good. And he went to be with her because I can't remember him smiling after she died. And so they're gone, you know. Gone. And so then my grandma called me one day and she said, "Megan, I've got your old woman's diaries here in the box. Would you like to read them?" And I said, "Yes. Yes, I would. Yes." And I got in my car and I drove the 4 blocks to my grandma's house and I picked up that box and inside the box, there's probably 30 years of diaries in there, 1 year, 30 books. And I took it home and I sent the kids outside because they'd be busy for a while. And I cracked that first one open, and I was like, "Oh my God, this is boring. There is nothing in here that I didn't hear her tell Louise on the party line at 3 o'clock. You know, 60 degrees today, a little chilly for April. You know, like, we got 4 inches of snow, and Ron got a late start today. You know, Leah brought her friend Paul for her birthday dinner. Leah is my sister. She's been married to Paul for 37 years. But that was a moment of import in her life. Mm-hmm. And so I'm like, all right, this is going to be rough. Because I'm a writer. I use words. I write poetry. I write stories. And I was looking for anything in these diaries that I could use to just memorialize her, pull out some small piece of her life, and just blow it up into something amazing. And there wasn't anything there. There was no name material. Nothing. She was a little bit about how she was feeling. Never anything about, "I think I'm going to die." Never anything about the Lord's coming for me. Just every day trying to get through. Ronnie made me milk toast. He wants me to try to eat more. When you have liver cancer, eating more is not the answer to what's happening inside your body. And then on the third to the last page of the diary, there was just a handwriting. And it said, "I know Wilma would be upset if there wasn't any kind of an entry in her diary. So this is Mary Lou, her baby sister." Mm-hmm. And then on the next page, ran up to see Wilma. She's still not interested in writing in her diary today, not enough energy. And it was Bernice, her other baby sister. Mm-hmm. And then I turned the page and bawled my eyes out. Because that page said, "Today, the best woman in the world died. She tried real hard right up to the very end. I already miss her. Love her." Mm. And I actually sobbed all the way here because I don't think I could tell this story. And I realized as I was going through there, looking for this grand thing to pull out, I realized I just read the greatest love story ever written on one page from a man who I never saw laugh, cry, smile, or even kiss his wife. Mm. Showed his love in the greatest and most amazing way. I haven't seen those diaries for 30 years. Yeah, 30 years. Mm. But I have that back page memorized. I only read it once, and I just sobbed. And I hope that you all have something like that in your lives. And I hope you all had an Andy Wilma. And I really just want to thank you for listening to my story today. Mm-hmm.